friends, YouTubers, going to read from like a what is considered a dedication. It could be considered a dedication prayer. It's from a book. It's not too long. It's from the 8th century in India. And this person is, I believe, is Indian and a student of Buddhism, and a monk, actually, was a monk. I believe he was a monk at the time he wrote this, or spoke this. And then somebody wrote it down and maybe fixed it and made it into a poem. But there's a, these are like, how many verses? It looks like 9 verses. Each verse has about 4 lines, and it was in a poem form, whatever that would be like in the original language. I believe the original language was in an Indian language, perhaps Sanskrit or something similar, a kind of Sanskrit. That was then, maybe several centuries later, translated into Tibetan when the Tibetan people had their written language designed to translate over from Sanskrit or some Indian language. What they had available for them in Buddhist literature of their time. They tried to translate everything over into Tibetan, and they were able to preserve a lot of Buddhism into Tibetan, into their Tibetan language. So the Tibetan people were able to preserve the Buddhism that developed in India around the 8th century and perhaps 9th and so on, to the point that eventually they were satisfied with all they got from India, and perhaps they couldn't get anything else because at some point or gradually Buddhism in India kind of fell apart, dwindled down, and sort of got replaced with Hinduism or whatever kinds of Hinduism there were at that time, and maybe Islam, and it just kind of faded away. Tibet became a preserver of Indian Buddhism eventually, perhaps by the 14th century, they were confident in the Buddhism that they had preserved, that they to not just preserve it, but develop it further, I would say, to make their own Buddhism and develop their own masters. But this, what I'm about to read, is from an Indian Buddhist, like a sage from India that was Buddhist around the 8th century. And this Indian Buddhist is highly regarded in Tibet to this very day. We don't know much about him, but there's stories about him. One story that I recall is that his fellow monks in this monastic university made fun of him because he wouldn't show up very much during the daytime. He would be sleeping during the daytime, it seemed like. I don't know, was he awake at night or what? Or he seemed to be sleeping all the time. and maybe get up for eating and going to the bathroom, I guess. So they said that they made fun of him by saying that this guy is his only, what they call, realizations, or experiences, were that he knew three things, eating and sleeping and defecating, or going to the bathroom. So this guy had the three realizations of eating, sleeping, and defecating. This guy, he became known by the name of Shantideva. Shanti, I recall, means peace in perhaps Sanskrit and other Indian languages, and Deva, it refers to divine. It could mean gods or whatever, or something divine or holy. Or I don't think it means God, just divine in general. So it's peace. Holy, peaceful, I don't know, however you want to think about it, or there might be a correct way of translating it over into English. Maybe not translating it, but interpreting it. But the two components are Shanti, which means peace, and Deva, holy or godlike. So maybe it's take what you want out of it. Shantideva, he had a name before that, but he became known by that name. I forgot what his name was before that, but let's see. He wrote, I assume he wrote many literatures or books or whatever, or he wrote, or unless he only wrote this, but he's famous for this particular book called the way of the Bodhisattva. Something like that. Or the Bodhisattva's way of life. So there's different ways of interpreting the title. In Spanish, they don't even use the word way. I forget what they use. I could look it up. I have internet, right? Isn't this wonderful? I got internet. Let's see. So I know, cause I bought the version in Spanish, and I looked at the net title of it the other day and said, "That's interesting how they translated it." It's let's see. Books. This book that he wrote, that I'm going to read about 9 verses from. Those 9 verses come from towards the end of the book. There's 10 chapters, and so these verses come from the 10th chapter. And the reason why I'm reading them is because they're very beautiful, I guess, and they would probably be even more beautiful if I knew Tibetan or Sanskrit and could read it in the original languages. Well, I would appreciate the poeticness of whoever turned it into poetry. Well, it depends on the language. Maybe it doesn't rhyme in those languages, but maybe it has a certain rhythm to it and a certain number of syllables per line. There's 4 lines per verse, and there's 9 verses. Let's see. Okay, here it is. In English, one way of calling it is Guide to the Bodhisattva's Way of Life. But in Spanish, okay, I'm going to click on Spanish, with Español, which converts the website into Spanish. Oh, it's interesting. So in Spanish, instead of calling it Way of Life, they call it, well, they translate Way of Life as Works. The works of the Bodhisattva. Well, in Spanish, it's obras. Obras are works. So in Spanish, they translated it or interpreted it as Guía de las Obras del Bodhisattva. And in English, they translated it as Guide to the Bodhisattva's Way of Life. This is from kadampa.org. I studied the book under the Kadampa Center near where I live. And I studied the commentary, which is a big, thick book. But the actual book by Shantideva is not too thick. It's 10 chapters. And each chapter is average length, not too long. So it's readable. But I haven't even really sat down to read it from the beginning to end. Just occasionally have read it. So I'm going to read the the 9 or so verses found in chapter 10, somewhere in chapter 10. Basically, these verses, most of them all start with the word may. So the word may suggests that we're wishing that this will happen. And we're kind of praying, but we're not, being that Buddhism is supposedly atheists, then you would not pray to any particular superior being, but just send it out to the universe, this wish, that these things happen. So Shantideva was finishing his book by what Buddhists call dedication, and they usually do it towards the end. At least I suppose that's the way they did it in India, in the Indian Buddhism of the 8th century, and that became a standard way of practice, of finishing off the session with a dedication. And the first time I encountered this dedication prayer was when I went to a Buddhist event. Must have been 5 or more years ago, where they went. This organization went on tour with a large display of relics of different masters who, over the centuries, from very recently to many centuries ago, who left relics. After they die, they leave something after their body has been cremated, usually, and they leave something, and they find it very unusual. They oftentimes, these little balls that look like pearls. So the people that did the cremation gathered these and made them special, and made them like sacred objects, and they preserved them over the centuries. And this organization somehow managed to get as many as they could of all these different masters, many of them from Tibet. And so they turned this into a museum, where they take this around to different places that are considered Buddhist, because I would say only the Buddhists would be interested in this, and they get donations that way, and the money gathered goes towards the building of a large Buddhist statue that I don't know if they're still doing that. It is supposed to be built, I believe, in somewhere in India or Nepal. And it's gonna be, it's supposed to be huge and be able, kind of like a Statue of Liberty kind of size, but it's a Buddha that's sitting down. I believe it's the Buddha or Bodhisattva Maitreya, kind of the Buddha that's supposed to be coming in the future. So this what was known as the relics tour, stopped by 1 year in Orlando, along with a jade Buddha, which was on display in some other temple in Orlando. And I got to see the jade Buddha. It's a big statue of Buddha made out of a piece of jade stone. A huge piece of jade, and somebody carved it out and made it into a Buddha that's sitting down. And I took some pictures of it. I guess you could look it up on the internet and find it. So that was on display in one temple, and I think it was a Vietnamese temple, and in another Vietnamese temple, they had the relics on display. And towards the end, they put all the relics in a bag, and then they put it on top of your head for people who wanted that, and supposedly it's supposed to bless you, because the energy that all these relics have, they all is all put together in one bag. So they kind of held the bag. It was like a 50-pound bag, so somebody strong enough would hold it about the level of your height, and then you would get under it, and they would lower it to your head for a few seconds, and then you would leave. So they made a line to where people would be touched by the relics on their head. And I went through that, so I felt blessed, that relics tour was on display for, I guess, a week in that temple, and the putting the relics on in the bag and getting under them, that was, I believe, the last day, and then... Oh, they also had where they touched your head with a relic, an individual relic. Some monk or nun would lift it, and you would bend down and have the relic be placed on top of your head. To the crown chakra or wherever, or the head in general. And so I encountered this this dedication prayer the last day of the relics tour, and it was one of the last things they did is to read this dedication prayer. Because when in this Buddhism, after you do some event or some meditation or some practice, it is a good idea or nice or beneficial for you to dedicate what you've done, and you try to dedicate it. Thinking about others, and you say whatever actions that were virtuous, and all this action may be if it's a virtue that could be accumulated in one's mind or wherever, and it's something that if it could be shared or given away, so the prayer is that you you generate the intention of giving it away to others. So you give it away by saying, may this happen, and you try to imagine what you want for others, others not just in your local area but all over the world. You try to expand it without limit. So you say, may all beings everywhere. So that suggests that you're not limiting it to just your friends and family, your loved ones, but include everyone, even animals. Yes, all sentient beings. They just say, may all beings, but I would insert sentient beings everywhere, to include animals and other kinds of beings. May all beings everywhere, plagued by sufferings of body and mind. That's the second line. The third line is, obtain an ocean of happiness and joy. And the fourth line is, by virtue of my merits. I get a message. Notification from my YouTube. Oh, shoot. I gotta turn the notifications off. So, let me repeat the first verse. May all beings everywhere, plagued by sufferings of body and mind, obtain an ocean of happiness and joy by virtue of my merits. So, the concept of merits is that whatever actions you do all day, and for having gone to the relics tour and gotten under the relics, those actions, because of their virtue, whatever little virtue that virtue was gathered, I'm not sure where it gets gathered. Maybe it's in the Akashic record, this virtue, or it's in your mind, or in the cloud. But you supposedly you would lay claim to it. We do by nature, whatever action or work we do, we hope we get benefits, personal benefit. Like we work for money and we work for love, we work to get stuff. In this case, we work to gain some merits. I guess you could say that merits are spiritual credits or good karma. You could say an alternative way of saying it. So, but first verse is suggesting that may these wonderful things happen because of the merits I've gained. In other words, I want to trade in my merits for the benefit of others. I'm imagining giving away my merits so that others may benefit from it. So, let me reread the first verse. May all beings everywhere, plagued by sufferings of body and mind, obtain an ocean of happiness and joy by virtue of my merits. And I think the rest of the verses are kind of going to be structured the same way. It's going to start off with may, and it's going to give us a topic of what kind of suffering there is, and then the third line was going to give a alternate version of the suffering, so the opposite. So if it talks about sickness, the third line will be about health, and so on. Maybe the third and fourth line would be like that. So each verse will still actually be it'll be implied that I'm gonna wish this to happen by me giving away my merits that I have accumulated today and perhaps all my life. So I have all this merit. Well, particularly in the event that I finish doing or whatever practice. Like if you meditate and you gather some merit, then you would give a dedication prayer, and you would give away all your merits during that prayer, and give it away to all beings. So let me repeat the first verse. May all beings everywhere, plagued by suffering of body and mind, obtain an ocean of happiness and joy by virtue of my merits. Now let's see how the second verse goes. May no living creature suffer, commit evil, or ever fall ill. May no one be afraid or belittled with a mind weighed down by depression. Okay, this verse had two lines, the first and third line, starting with May. So you could say this verse talked about two different conditions. Well, the first condition was that the wish is that no living creature suffer, commit evil, or ever fall ill. And the second wish is that may no one be afraid or belittled with a mind weighed down by depression. I don't know. The second wish, it's a nice wish, but it doesn't kind of make sense. Well, it makes sense, but I wonder what the translation was like, or the original was like. May no one be afraid or belittled with a mind weighed down by depression. May no one be afraid or belittled, comma, with a mind weighed down by depression. I'll have to look at an alternative translation of that verse. Let's see. I wonder if I can find... let's see. I can find it online. Chapter 1. I said chapter 10. How come they're showing me chapter 1? Chapter 3, chapter 8. Maybe it's because chapter 1 is most often looked up. Let's see. I'm trying to put a... Okay. Chapter 10. Here's one. Kempo Kumpal. Chapter 10. Dedication. General dedication of virtue to free the three realms of suffering. Chapter online. Oh, MP3. Rigpa Shedra. That's an interesting... Anyone? Chapter 1, Chapter 1, Chapter 10. Damn. It's not even the book. Shantideva's Guide to the Bodhisattvas. Internet Archive. Archive.org. I hope it's not an MP3. Let's see. Notes. First lung. They got MP3s, but I wonder if I can find the... Yep. Can't find it written. Maybe I have this book in Kindle. Okay, let me...